Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for the fall 2015 Alan T. and Linda M. Beimfohr Lecture. My name is Carl Johnson. I'm the executive director of Chesterton House, the sponsor of this afternoon's lecture. Chesterton House is a center for Christian studies and an affiliate member of Cornell United Religious Work. Over the last 15 years, Chesterton House has sponsored a distinguished public lecture series that has included leading scholars and public intellectuals, including historian Mark Knoll, philosopher Eleanor Stump, physicist Sir John Polkinghorne, and Cornell's own Nobel laureate in chemistry, Roald Hoffman. The Beimfohr Lecture, which is designed to address issues of faith in a pluralistic society, is made possible by Carl and Elaine Noyce and named for their friends, Al and Linda Beimfohr. Carl Noyce is class of 1976, and the late Al Beimfohr was a member of the class of 1966. Past Beimfohr lecturers have included historian John Somerville, sociologist Felicia Wu Song, World Vision president and Cornell alumnus Richard Stearns. And I would like to extend our sincere thanks and also a warm welcome to the Noyce and Beimfohr families as they join us via webcast from Southern California. Before I turn things over, I should also mention that our speakers' books will be available for signing and purchase in the lobby after the lecture. And now to introduce our speaker, we're very privileged to have with us a man who needs no introduction, President Emeritus Frank Rhodes.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to add my welcome to all of you today, and especially to welcome back to Cornell, Joe Holland. Cornell alumnus, emeritus member of the Board of Trustees, and also an ordained minister, an attorney, a civic leader, and an activist entrepreneur. Joe, thank you for making the trip to Ithaca and for being part of this special celebration, as well as this lecture. I've had the privilege of knowing Joe and his family for many years. Joe was a Cornell student during the first year that I came to Cornell. He was an excellent student, an academic, all-American, but it was on the football field that the wider community got to know Joe. He earned the admiration of everybody because in that cold, wet, long winter that my first one marked, he was an outstanding member of the team. He was a tailback, and he was the second Ivy player in history to gain over 1,000 yards in one season, and he was the team's most valuable player. In 1990, he was inducted into the Cornell Athletic Hall of Fame. Joe earned his bachelor's degree with a double major in English and history. And he stayed on after 78, when he graduated, to earn a master's degree before moving on to Harvard, where he was awarded a law degree. And like his late father, Presidential Counselor Jerome Brud Holland of the class of 39, for whom our International Living Center is named, and who himself went on to a very distinguished career. President of two different universities, ambassador to Sweden, chairman of the American Red Cross, and the first Afro-American member of the New York Stock Exchange Board. He was not only a good student, but a remarkable athlete and an engaged Cornellian. Joe has served on the administrative board of the Cornell Council. He served on the advisory councils of human ecology and athletics, and for a dozen years, he was a member of the Cornell University Board of Trustees. A commitment to serving his community has been central to Joe's life, and the community he's chosen has been Harlem, where he has been helping those to help themselves. He is, as a young lawyer, he turned down attractive offers from Wall Street law firms and chose instead to offer a one-man law office in Harlem, which, as he called it, was a swamp of intractable poverty. Rapidly, his work grew, and he became legal counsel to Christ Community Church of Harlem and was an ordained assistant pastor there. In 1986, Joe founded Harlem's Ark of Freedom, a shelter for homeless men that offered not just housing, but also life skills along with housing to its residents. He co-founded Beth Hark Crisis Center for addicts and ex-offenders. And at one point, he worked with former Cornell English professor, the late Scott McMillan, and the Cooperative Extension Program at Cornell to open in Harlem a private pilot literacy program for inner city youth. Joe went on to serve in other positions. He was under Governor Pataki for 2 years, state housing commissioner, and he has also been a spokesman for GTE, for its academic All-American program. It's with the greatest pleasure that we welcome him back today. And as you heard from Carl, his new book, The Touchstone Tools, Building Your Way to an Inspired Life, is something that's going to be of particular interest. At a time when issues of race have again come to the fore, in Ferguson, Missouri, and Charleston, South Carolina, it's refreshing to have Joe Holland speak to us and to share his perspective on what the future may hold. Joe, with the greatest pleasure, we welcome you back to Cornell.
Thank you, Frank, so much. Thank you, Frank, so much for that introduction. I've known President Emeritus Rhodes since the time I was a student here, and then as an alum, and then as a trustee, and it's really my privilege now that I can count him as a friend. Thank you so much, Frank. Thank you all for being here. Just a couple of special acknowledgments that I'd like to make before I get into my talk. So many friends and Cornellians that I've had such great relationship over the years, but I do want to recognize, I saw one of my former professors here, Professor Larry Moore is here, and I really appreciate him being here. And also, I'm really thrilled that my daughter, who is a sophomore here at Cornell, Shelby Holland, is here. So we're really, really pleased to have her. You know, it's great coming back to Cornell. It's always a great, great feeling. But I do have to acknowledge that where I've spent most of my time since graduation in Harlem, I don't always get the best Cornell reception. I remember when I was fresh out of law school looking for a job in Harlem, and I went to interview with a legendary Harlem attorney, Cora Walker, and I went in, I had my resume, and I presented it, and I was talking up my two Cornell degrees and my Harvard degree, and she put down the resume and looked at me and said, "Young man, don't you know that ivy doesn't grow on 125th Street?" Suffice it to say, I didn't get the job. And a few years later, in the homeless shelter that I was running, there was a resident I was trying to counsel. His name was Carter. And on one day, I was particularly frustrated with Carter because he wasn't listening to anything I was saying. And so I said, "Carter, don't you know that I have 3 Ivy League degrees? And he looked at me and said, big deal. I went to UCLA. And I looked at him and said, I was shocked. I said, you went to UCLA? And he said, yeah. I finished the university on the corner of Lenox Avenue. You will hear some more themes of the Ivy inner city connection in my talk entitled Racial Justice, Revival, and the Refounding of America. Almost a century ago, Langston Hughes, the poet laureate of Harlem, penned a poem entitled Harlem. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat? Or crust and sugar over like syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load. Or does it explode? Might I offer a paraphrase of Hughes' poetic query? What happens to the American dream deferred? Perhaps my new phrase, the American dream, was implicit. I discern the bigger meaning is what Hughes really had in mind. Didn't he entitle the poem Harlem, which is the long suffering lodestar for African American aspirations? My search for an answer reaches back hundreds, even thousands of years before the founding declarations that inspired America's dream. As a Cornell undergrad, in a small room at the top of McGraw Hall, in a history seminar with the legendary Fred Marcham, who at the time was approaching the autumn of his 68-year Cornell teaching career. He recounted the day in 1215, yes, exactly 800 years ago, at Runnymede, a meadow on the River Thames, 20 miles from London, when 40 barons presented to King John of England their statement of feudal rights, which came to be known as Magna Carta, the Great Charter, which evolved over time into a symbol of liberty and rule of law, even providing inspiration 500 years later for the founding of America. Professor Marcham described how one of the barons referred to the Old Testament leader Moses, the liberator of an oppressed people, as his inspiration for demanding the Great Charter. As a young Christian, I was struck by the biblical reference, especially when the connection between religion and reform resurfaced during an American intellectual history lecture. Professor Larry Moore noted that the first great awakening, the 18th century religious revival beginning in the 1730s and permeating the 13 colonies for decades thereafter, had a profound impact on the culture and politics of the era. My own research revealed that this movement had been largely sparked by George Whitefield, the young Anglican preacher who toured the colonies, attracting large crowds and gaining countless conversions. One of Whitefield's most prominent disciples was Samuel Davies, the Presbyterian minister who later became the fourth president of Princeton University. Davies was known for conducting revivals among African slaves and promoting the literacy of slaves so that they could read the Bible. Such advocacy made all the difference to a particular female slave named Phyllis Wheatley, who was brought from West Africa to Boston in 1761. She converted to Christianity, was taught to read the Bible, and eventually became the first published African-American poet. One of her poems she dedicated to George Whitefield after his death, describing him as the one who pointed her to Jesus. She called Jesus an impartial savior because Whitefield preached him to blacks, whites, and anyone who would listen. Whitefield's favorite place to preach in America was Philadelphia, where a chapel was specially built for him, a building that eventually became the first home of the University of Pennsylvania. Benjamin Franklin heard Whitefield preach at the chapel and was so moved that he published all of Whitefield's sermons and journals in his Gazette, devoting 45 issues to Whitefield's activities, with many of the preacher's words gracing the front page. Thus, the ecclesiastical environment helped to create the ideological milieu that led to America's founding. Gaining freedom from personal sin, which was the thrust of the religious awakening, was easily translated by American revolutionaries of this period into a political awakening, gaining freedom from political sins like taxation without representation. The core value of spiritual freedom spawned constitutional principles, freedom of speech, of the press, of religion, the inalienable rights of life and liberty. Perhaps most fundamental to the founders were the ideas of human dignity and equality, which stem from the Christian precept that we are all created by God and in His image. When pro-slavery delegates to the Constitutional Convention in 1787 insisted that slavery be incorporated in the Constitution as a federally sanctioned institution, James Madison countered, though he was a slaveholder himself, that it would be wrong to admit in the Constitution as it would be wrong to admit the Constitution the idea that there could be property in man. Madison did make compromises with the pro-slavery faction, the Three-Fifths Clause, as well as the continuation of the slave trade for 20 more years. But he did not cave in to their big demand. The Constitutional Convention defeated the initiative to establish slavery as a national institution, setting the stage for the epical battles over racial justice that predominated 19th century American culture and politics. What George Whitefield was to the First Great Awakening, Francis Asbury, another English clergyman turned itinerant American preacher, was to its successor. The spread and impact of Christianity generally referred to as the Second Great Awakening. This revival began in the dawn of the 19th century and gained momentum through its early decades. One of the first two bishops of the Methodist Episcopal Church in the United States, Asbury took the evangelical message by horse-drawn carriage thousands of miles beyond the Eastern Seaboard elite to those hardy souls pioneering on the American frontier. Driving Asbury on his circuits was freedman Harry Hosier, who learned so well along the way that he became a preacher in his own right, even a crossover success, as popular among white audiences as his own race, delivering the first sermon in American history by a black directly to a white congregation. Asbury often had Hosier preach, since he recognized him as a speaker far more effective than himself. Hosier's trailblazing laid the foundation for African American Methodism, leading to the establishment of independent African American denominations, the African Methodist Episcopal Church and the African Episcopal Zion Church, of which Sojourner Truth, Harriet Tubman, and Frederick Douglass all became members. I remember childhood stories told to me by my Cornell legend dad, Jerome Brudholland, who was born and raised in Auburn, New York, the town where Harriet Tubman settled after the Underground Railroad. Dad shared with me what he'd heard growing up around the family dinner table. Vivid memories of Black Moses. That's what he called her. Not only her heroics freeing slaves, but also her spirit-filled worship, recalling how she would run around the sanctuary of Thompson Memorial AME Zion Church, testifying of God's goodness and power, praising the Lord with voice, hands, and feet. Like its western neighbor, Auburn, Ithaca was part of the burned over district, a term coined by Charles Finney, Presbyterian minister and Oberlin College president. Known as the father of modern revivalism, Finney, in the tradition of Whitfield, conducted open field or tent meetings full of joyous singing, fiery preaching, tearful confessions, numerous conversions, with the new believers brimming with the moral imperative to act to right the wrongs of the world. Finney described the western and central regions of New York, where the Second Great Awakening flourished, as a burnt district, an area that had been so heavily evangelized as to have no fuel, that is, unconverted population, left over to burn, that is, convert. What an ironic legacy for a place as secular as Cornell to be have founded on ground that was burned over. Frederick Douglass was a spiritual offspring of the Second Great Awakening. He heard his slave master's wife reading the Bible. He began reading and copying Bible verses and listening to sermons. He described his conversion to Christianity in his autobiography, Life and Times of Frederick Douglass. I was not more than 13 years old when my loneliness and destitution, the preaching of a white Methodist minister, was the means of causing me to feel that in God I had such a friend. I consulted a good old colored man who told me to pray and to cast all my care upon God. Though for weeks I was poor, brokenhearted mourner, traveling through doubts and fears, I finally found my burden lightened and my heart relieved. I saw the world in a new light. Douglass later joined the AME Zion Church and became a licensed preacher, holding various positions, including steward, Sunday school superintendent, and sexton. He believed that his individual spiritual experience was inextricably linked to social reform, exhorting, "Let the religious press, the pulpit, the Sunday school, the missionary associations of the land array their immense powers against slavery and slaveholding, and the whole system of crime and blood would be scattered to the winds." Though both members of the nascent Republican Party, Douglass did not support Abraham Lincoln in the 1860 presidential election. Their goals differed. Lincoln's to save the Union, Douglass's to free the slaves. But like Douglass, Lincoln's views had been influenced by the Second Great Awakening. In 1863, Lincoln declared a proclamation appointing a national fast day with these words: "Whereas it is the duty of nations as well as men to recognize the sublime truth announced in the Holy Scriptures and proven by all history, those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord. We have been recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever grown. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us. It behooves us then to humble ourselves before the offended power, to confess our national sins, and to pray for clemency and forgiveness. So said President Lincoln in March 1863, not long after he decreed the Emancipation Proclamation, and not long before he met with Douglas for the first time, an unprecedented White House invitation from an American president to an African American. Their relationship matured through several ensuing meetings with a deepening mutual respect and emerging ideological convergence, helping to pave the way for the 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery. This constitutional watershed, along with the other post-war amendments and Reconstruction, could be characterized as a 19th century refounding movement, a season of hope for those clinging to deferred dreams, seemingly finally free to pursue the founding promises long denied them. But Reconstruction was short-lived, little more than 10 years, and in its wake rose the Jim Crow caste system, spawning generations of de facto and de jure segregation, separate but equal laws, lynchings, racial disadvantage, so devastating that Black America as a whole, a sesquicentennial later, has yet to recover. What happens to the American dream deferred? Following its 18th and 19th century antecedents, a 20th century revival emerged, which I call the Third Great Awakening, which became the religious and cultural context for the civil rights movement. This great awakening followed World War II, when church membership increased, Sunday morning attendance soared, seminary enrollments escalated, and campus ministries were born. I myself am a spiritual offspring of this Third Great Awakening, for the mid-20th century revival spawned two campus ministries, Athletes in Action and Fellowship of Christian Athletes. Their missions were to minister to college athletes. These campus ministries co-sponsored a retreat that I attended as a college freshman, during which time I discovered my own Christian faith. In 1930, less than half of Americans, 47%, were formally affiliated with a church. By 1960, that number soared to over two-thirds of Americans, 69%. Church construction surged, attempting to keep pace with church membership, which was growing almost twice as fast as the American population. From 26 million in new church building in 1945 to 409 million in 1950 to $1 billion in 1960. The capstone of the era's rise in sacred architecture was the Protestant Vatican, the new Manhattan headquarters of the National Council of Churches, a 19-story skyscraper funded by John D. Rockefeller Jr., who guaranteed a rent-free 99-year lease. The cornerstone for this religious monument was laid in 1958 by President Dwight D. Eisenhower, who marched with 300 religious leaders flourishing the 37 banners of the participating denominations and heralded the nation's churches as sturdy defenders of the constitutional and God-given rights of each citizen. The 20th century revival deeply infused popular culture, as a 1953 Publishers Weekly report confirmed, stating, "The theme of religion dominates the nonfiction bestsellers." Hollywood epics like The Robe, produced in 1953, The Ten Commandments, 1956, Ben-Hur, 1959, Barabbas, 1961, graced the big screen. The sale of Bibles soared, increasing 140% in the early 1950s. C.S. Lewis, Paul Tillich, John Courtney Murray among other mid-century religious leaders, found themselves on the cover of Time magazine. Four of these leaders embodied this 20th century revival. The Protestant intellectual was Reinhold Niebuhr, who argued that after the countless casualties in death camps of the 1930s and 1940s, the progressive belief that the liberalism of the modern age promised ever greater enlightenment and peace had proven naive and Panglossian. Instead, Niebuhr championed prophetic Christianity, asserting the foundational principles of Protestantism as more effective than the liberal ideals of modernism in the battle for civilization, which was being imperiled by both communism and secularism. The Catholic bishop was Fulton Sheen, who mastered American media as a radio broadcaster on the Catholic Hour in the 1930s and 1940s, moving to primetime TV in the 1950s, transforming the ABC 8 p.m. time slot from ratings graveyard to hotspot, attracting 30 million weekly viewers. When accepting his Emmy, Sheen quipped, "I'd like to thank my writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John." What Whitfield and Davies were to the 18th century revival, and what Asbury and Finney were to the 19th century revival, Billy Graham was to the 20th century revival. An advisor to presidents, Graham drew huge crowds wherever he preached, his ministry attaining its summit during his New York City crusade of 1957. 16 weeks at Madison Square Garden with a standing room only crowd of 20,000 every night, 3,000 ushers, 4,000 member choir, thousands to counsel those who answered Graham's call for conversion, hour-long TV broadcasts. Even the New York Times printed the text of his sermons. 100,000 people at Yankee Stadium for a midsummer service, breaking the record set by the Joe Louis-Max Baer fight. And another 100,000 for the Labor Day weekend finale in Times Square. On one of the nights of the New York City meetings, Billy Graham invited Martin Luther King Jr. to lead the public prayer. King turned out to be the most transformative clergyman of this third great awakening. His leadership of the civil rights movement leavened Christian theology with social activism in unprecedented ways. At the beginning in 1955, King exhorted the Montgomery bus boycotters, "We must keep God in the forefront. Let us be Christian in all our actions." Established a couple years later, King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference encouraged civil rights protesters to accept Christian love in full knowledge of its power to defy evil. And in his pivotal 1962 letter from a Birmingham jail, King not only quoted Reinhold Niebuhr, but also Augustine, Aquinas, Martin Luther, John Bunyan, T.S. Eliot, and of course Jesus, drawing analogies to the Old Testament prophet Amos and the New Testament apostle Paul as well. As King moved from Birmingham jail to streets, Fred Shuttlesworth, his lieutenant there, described the movement as Christianity's greatest opportunity in centuries to make religion real in the lives of men. The ensuing circumstance of black protesters praying and singing while segregationist policemen loosed dogs and water cannons on them created enduring images of the Christian gospel being fully lived. The irony is that it was the faith of old-time religion, not the dogma of modern secularism, that inspired a mass movement to fulfill the promise of America's founding. The Christian character of the civil rights movement climaxed with King's "I Have a Dream" speech. King's dream had biblical roots, paraphrasing the prophet Isaiah. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it. The subtext of King's speech that day in the summer of 1963 could very well have been a variation on the theme of Hughes's poetic query of a generation earlier. What has happened to the American dream deferred? Or phrased prospectively, what will happen to the American dream fulfilled? King's tour de force at the Lincoln Memorial fueled an ecumenical initiative launched by a strategy session at the Kennedy White House a few months earlier to bring together religious leaders with civil rights activists to build support for civil rights legislation among church-going Americans, and most significantly, among the crucial constituency, the white Protestant churches of the South. The church-based strategy bore fruit in the passage of landmark legislation, civil rights in 1964 and voting rights in 1965. As the time for the voting on the Civil Rights Act approached, lobbying for it by pastors, bishops, rabbis, and priests intensified. Richard Russell, the veteran segregationist senator from Georgia, complained memorably about the reason for the passage of this legislation. The only way it passed, he grumbled, is because those damn preachers got the idea that it was a moral issue. Over the American centuries, the strategic union of Christian faith and political activism matured. As King's 20th century movement succeeded, with protests of nonviolent instead of conflicts of bloodshed that made 18th and 19th century social change possible. Its triumph rose by projecting the message of Christian love as a universal mandate, transcending racial, denominational, even partisan divisions, bringing together Jew and Gentile, Democrat and Republican, Catholic and Protestant, white and black, in support of American ideals. Yes, a 20th century refounding movement rising from the distinct cultural and political world that the Third Great Awakening had made. If the historical pattern of religious revival and racial reform were to hold for the present era, then a fourth great awakening would seem to be in order. Since the 18th, 19th, and 20th century, religious movements paved the way for social change towards racial judgment, racial justice. Wouldn't a 21st century awakening be auspicious? But it's reported, America is moving in the opposite direction. Social commentators and media experts assert that Christianity has fallen on hard times. They cite the Pew Center Research Center report published earlier this year, with data showing that younger Americans are far more likely than any previous generation to lack any religious affiliation. The report concluded, the Christian share of the U.S. population is declining, while the number of U.S. adults who do not identify with any organized religion is growing. They also assert internet data. Google searches for churches are 15% lower in the first half of this decade than they were during the last half of the previous one. Searches questioning God's existence are up. The top Google search, including the word God, is God of War, a video game with more than 700,000 searches per year. And don't forget the growing readership of such atheism books as The God Delusion by Richard Dawkins and God Is Not Great by Christopher Hitchens. This modernity equals secularization trend makes it increasingly difficult for many to acknowledge that Christianity could play a role in these times, as it has in the past, in rectifying the legacies of America's original sin of slavery. But might secularism's self-proclaimed victory over religion be a bit premature? God works in mysterious ways. Pope Francis's recent U.S. visit was a sensation, exalted by nonstop media coverage, embraced by the adoring masses. The Francis phenomenon points to the limits of secularism's hold. His venerated American tour climaxed for me with his homily at his Madison Square Garden Mass before 20,000, where he quoted the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. The Pope also proclaimed hope that night, a hope which liberates us from the forces pushing us to isolation and lack of concern for the lives of others. A hope for the life of our city, a hope which frees us from empty connections, from abstract analysis or sensationalist routines. A hope which is unafraid of involvement, which acts as a leaven wherever we happen to live and work. A hope that makes us see, even in the midst of smog, the presence of God as he continues to walk the streets of our city. Such a hope is urgently needed as a light against the enduring, encircling gloom of race in America. The Kerner Commission, appointed by President Lyndon Johnson almost 50 years ago because U.S. cities were burning during the race riot summers of the 60s, concluded that America still lived in two societies, one white, one black, separate, and still unequal. Since then, the percentage of African-American births to single women has tripled, going from 24 to 72%. Also, since then, America has become the world's most incarcerated nation, with the cost of running this prison-industrial complex of mass incarceration approximately $67 billion annually, yielding more black men in jail than in college. What happens to the American dream deferred? A recent New York Times report entitled 1.5 million black men missing showed that more than one in every six black men in the 24 to 54 age group has disappeared from civil life, mainly because they died young or are locked away in prison. This shortfall in black men translates into lower marriage rates, more out-of-wedlock births, a greater risk of poverty for families, and by extension, less stable communities. What happens to the American dream deferred? Just in the last year or so, Michael Brown, Eric Garner, John Crawford, Walter Scott, Ezell Ford, Tamir Rice, Freddie Gray, Akai Gurley, the seemingly unending chain of killings, some video recorded of unarmed black men at the hands of police, which was poignantly punctuated by the massacre of nine black parishioners at the Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston at the hands of a young white supremacist. What happens to the American dream deferred? The median net worth for white households in 2013 was $141,900, about 13 times that of black households at 11,000. And black children were almost four times as likely as white children to be living in poverty in 2013. But even more troubling in absolute terms, for the first time since the federal government started collecting the data, the number of black children in poverty had overtaken the number of poor white children, 4.2 million to 4.1. What happens to the American dream deferred? In a national poll conducted over the summer, nearly 6 in 10 Americans, including heavy majorities of both whites and blacks, think race relations are generally bad, compared with 2/3 of Americans surveyed shortly after President Obama took office, who said in 2008 that race relations were generally good. What happens to the American dream deferred? The Republican presidential candidate leading the polls is a celebrity candidate who refers to America as a hellhole and American leaders as babies who are so stupid that they can only watch helpless as we become a third world country. The leading Democratic candidate is a legacy candidate caught in an email scandal, leaving many Americans believing, according to polls, that she is dishonest. And the former House Speaker recently resigned because of raging divisiveness within his own party, with no one, it seems, really wanting to take on the Speaker's job. Some envisioned, or at least hoped, that the election of the first black president would be a racial game changer. It hasn't been, not yet. And time is running out. It might even be argued that beyond the symbolism of Obama's ascendance and the great expectations it spawned lies a growing psychological dissonance of deferred dreams. And now, in this critical time, we have on deck Ben Carson. The disparity and disadvantage of race in America these days are certainly not new, but their downward spiral argues that our trek towards racial justice is looking more like a dance, one step forward, two steps back. The precedents of American history imply that racial progress will more likely rise from the spiritual ferment of a 21st century great awakening rather than the grandiose theories of armchair secularists, rather than from the perpetual pontifications of partisan politicians. I applaud campus organizations like Chesterton House and the Cornell United Religious Work, the sponsors of today's event, who understand the importance of cultivating, celebrating, and promoting the religious as well as the intellectual. Perhaps they and faithful others might discover a modern day burned over district from which a 21st century revival, a great awakening for our times, could possibly rise from right here in Ithaca. Hope springs eternal. And I encourage pluralistic research universities like Cornell not to worship at the altar of modern secularism, but to embrace the challenge of exploring the dynamic link of religious revival and social reform, researching the rich historical dialectic, then extending it for much needed contemporary applications. Perhaps an expanded educational quest to cultivate the whole student, the moral and spiritual, as well as the intellectual and professional dimensions, might yield fewer careerists, but more visionaries. What if Cornell Cooperative Extension, the university's land grant outreach with operations in every county of New York State, added to its traditional offerings of youth baking and gardening a new curriculum to highlight racial justice in ways to deepen understanding, sensitize conversation, and bridge community? What if students at colleges across America, perhaps starting with a chapter right here at Cornell, resolved to give our nation a 250th birthday gift, a far-reaching foray to fix, at long last, America's racial breakdown? Not decreed from the state houses, but rising from the grassroots. A modern day awakening that would inspire across the lines of race, ethnicity, and religion to spiritually uplift the prosperous and materially uplift the poor, resulting in a refounding movement for our times. What if the Cornell Prison Education Program, which already deploys students and faculty providing classes and degree programs in four regional prisons, would it be strengthened and expanded as a national model with the goal of attaining a milestone by the year 2026, more black men in college than in prison? That would be one nice way to say happy 250th birthday, America. And what if these student visionaries discovered other ways to flip the racial script, conquering disparities not only in education and criminal justice, but in poverty, in healthcare, and employment as well? What a refounding celebration that would be. A big old party stretching from 125th Street to Main Street, from the South Bronx to the Arts Quad, from Rikers Island to Times Square. And what if churches join the students in this refounding movement, declaring that Sunday morning will no longer be the most segregated time in America, forming a community-based infrastructure from campus to campus, from congregation to congregation, from neighborhood to neighborhood, proclaiming a new vision, raising a prophetic voice, calling this nation to the higher ground of faith, hope, and love, to lower all of our Confederate flags, not only the ones flying over our state houses, but the banners of intolerance, inequity, and hate still unfurled in our homes and reigning in our hearts. It's been 800 years since the Magna Carta, and the spirit of the Great Charter still lives with roots running back to biblical times. As we approach 250 years of this American experiment, let us acknowledge that it is still a work in progress. Let us be humble enough to accept that there's still unfinished business. And let us be visionary enough for a golden age when the founding ideals of liberty, equality, and justice can become reality for all Americans. And finally, let us be courageous enough to ask afresh the question still echoing from the poetry of Hughes, the vision of King, the faith of Douglas, Tubman, and Wheatley, bequeathed across the centuries to us diehard dreamers of this dawning quarter millennial moment. What happens to the American dream fulfilled? Will it rise up like the glory of the sun? Or will it stride like a champion on her run? Will it brim with justice for all? Or heed the beckoning of freedom's call? Maybe it revives a declaration passed with a trumpet blast.
We're going to take some time for questions. We'll be moving some microphones on stands into the aisles. To expedite matters, if you have a question, please step forward and form a line so we can keep things moving.
I don't know if I have the second half of the question, but as a Cornellian and as the revolutionaries we are told Ezra, Andrew, and then maybe Carl Becker were, it has always been interesting to me, the Cornell motto, that we always talk about the any person and the any study. But I'm a linguist, and it's the wood that has always been profoundly of interest to me, and Ezra's dream and Andrew's dream. And I wonder what you thought their dream really was and where they thought we might be at this time. The letter unearthed by Ezra said to the coming man and woman. And I'd wonder where on the curve we've been and where that motto has taken us. We have been anti-Semitic. We have had separation of races. We have had all sorts of the ugliness that our world says. Is there something about Ezra's motto that has kept us recorrecting? Or have we just been average, and where might our Cornell dream be 20 years from now? I don't know if there's an answer, but it's where my head always lies.
Thank you for raising that question. And that question really goes to why I'm glad I'm a Cornellian. You know, why I'm here today speaking. I got the invitation, and the visionary dimension of what I've talked about, my Cornell experience did and indeed help to cultivate it. It put me in an environment where, you know, I could see beyond, you know, what I was thinking and looking at in terms of a career, and thinking more about how I could be a player and make a difference in society. So, it's hard to capture and articulate, but I do think there's something philosophical and even spiritual in the Cornell heritage that we Cornellians need to take seriously and take an inner look at us as individual Cornellians and our institution, and what is it that we can do even more. I think that, and I mentioned a couple of specific examples, that Cornell, because it is a land-grant University of New York State, and it has this mission not only of teaching research, but also to extend knowledge. And so we do have it as part of our institutional, you know, mission to take what we have and to extend it. And I think the thrust of my comments today is that we can be, both as individuals and as an institution, more intentional about how we think about that mission to address some of the racial justice issues that are still raging in our society.
Okay, I'm short too, but so you were talking a bit about like the awakenings, the third great awakening, and how you believe that like a fourth great awakening would really be like positive or key to racial justice. Could you talk a little bit about, if that were to happen, how that could bring unity when it would be in a Christian context centered around the person of Jesus in a society that is not centered around the person of Jesus?
Thanks. Yeah, it's a great question. And my first response to that is God works in mysterious ways. And so to kind of understand exactly how that would unfold and take shape is a real challenge. And that's why I wanted to center my talk in the historical analogs, because I think it's really important that we understand, you know, it was the movements in a society that were really being motivated and led by men and women of faith. And the faith was really central to them. It was a core to who they were and what they were doing that, you know, allowed them to take the steps and, you know, to make a difference in society, not only in their, you know, individual lives and families and communities, but for a nation as a whole. Now, specific to your question, though, you know, I do think it's something that happens at the grassroots with individuals, you know, either, you know, in their, you know, own groups or in their own churches, and they come together and say, okay, you know, we see the problem in our community. We see the problem in our neighborhood. We are going to, you know, reach out, and we're going to pray. We're going to meet. We're going to fast. We're going to do whatever we need to do to start to address the problem there. I do think it starts very local, and I think the civil rights movement is a great analogy of this. You know, what happens, you know, in a very local way, where you just start boycotting on a bus, you know, becomes something that over time can change, change the law of the land and shift the entire dynamic within the society. And so even as you ask me the question, you know, I would come back and challenge you, what is it that either you're doing or you can do or can do more in order to help, address some of these problems? And then, and I think this is an important part of being part of an academic community, you can be intentional about, you know, studying it, documenting it, analyzing it, and, seeing how some real paradigms can be created that can make a difference not only here but elsewhere.
Okay, Joe. Joe, it won't surprise you to say that I'm very proud of you, that you haven't forgotten how to think historically and use it very effectively to illuminate where we are today. This is really a question that I hope on your next visit to Cornell we can talk about, but I do think it is a mistake in our contemporary world, especially, to draw too firm a line when we talk about people of goodwill and the things that we can do to achieve racial justice, to draw a firm line between the religious and the secular, implying that on one side there is something spiritually lacking. On the secular side of things lie a lot of hope and a lot of people who also have their faith, but it's just not a faith that's centered in the churches. And I think that population is in fact increasing, and we should encourage it to be good rather than as something that is dangerous to our future.
Well, I appreciate that perspective, Larry, and if, you know, I either stated or implied that it was somehow not good when secular people are doing things that are in the community interest or will move the ball forward on racial justice, then, I apologize for that impression, because that certainly is not my impression. I did want to highlight from the history, and these were, examples that I thought spoke to the theme of how you move the ball forward in our society on racial justice. And to me, from my reading of the history as you heard today, that's happened with a lot of influence from faith communities and a lot of leadership from people and institutions of faith. Now, it would be wonderful if the leadership on these issues came from both faith as well as the secular side, and that they could come together and walk together and see the tide turn on racial justice in America. But my conclusion based on research that I've done is that there's a lot of hope when men and women of faith rise up and really take the leadership on these issues. But I would love to get together and talk with you about that some more.
One more question.
So I really enjoyed what you talked about, the historical perspective of how racial reconciliation was improved when Christianity was revived. So do you think part of the reason we seem to be losing ground in the last few years is because of Christians not getting out in society and not really seeing as much faith-based motivation and more of a political approach to these issues?
Well, I mean, that's certainly an issue that I think should be really studied and researched. I mean, I don't want to suggest a direct correlation between the lack of Christian involvement and the growing racial problems. I certainly don't have any data or evidence to support that. We certainly can say that if there was more of faith-based engagement around the issues that we're talking about, then based on the history, there would, in my mind, be greater hope that we would, move in a positive direction here, and that's one of the important themes that I wanted to highlight in my talk today, and I'm hoping that all of us here will kind of think about how we as individuals can get involved in these kinds of issues. Thank you for your question.
We are at the end of our time. A reminder as we wrap up that we do have copies of Mr. Holland's books in the lobby that are available for signing and for purchase. And please join me in extending a thanks to Mr. Joe Holland.
Thank you.